You do them all over or just...
We do them all over, basically, at hotels, mostly.
Yeah.
And so we go from hotel to hotel, and Anka tries to make them look pretty. And there's usually a plant involved.
Yeah.
That doesn't quite work, but, you know, it's all we have. We're doing the best we can with
a
the four seasons.
A matching plant.
It's so hard to be
like
the four
Zach Galifianakis between two plants.
That's right. I guess you've already sat in a hotel room for this.
Yes.
In front of a poster for your movie.
Yes.
Was that a fun experience?
It's amazing the way they transformed the hotel room. It was kind of a nice hotel room, and then it became a studio. It was sort of...
But was talking... I mean, this is the first time you've really been a front man for the movie.
Yeah.
Was it interesting having 28 people or 58 people or 78 people asking you the same question over and over again?
Yeah, yeah. It was kind of funny, and there were different sort of angles on the questions and... You know, and also the different, you know, like the Finns, like when we did their premiere in Finland, the Finns had a whole other, culturally, they're a whole other sort of, the press sat there for a long time. And then one person asked a question, and then they all started to ask. It was like the lead guy asked a question, and then they all started. So they were very reserved and kind of, you know.
The alpha to kind of break
Yes, ice. Yes. Exactly.
Did you ever think you would grow up to be doing a press conference for Angry Birds in Finland?
Not remotely. Not remotely. It was kind of a really amazing experience to go back to Helsinki and just where it was all sort of born, you know, and see the Finns react to, you know, the birth of their product, you know, like sort of this whole new thing that they hadn't seen the movie yet. So,
is there a national pride about Angry Birds? Is that?
I think so, because you know they're kind of well known at this point for technology companies. You know, they formed Nokia, that's a Finnish company, and they're into startups, and they're into sort of, you know. There's a couple of other gaming companies there as well, I think. So they take pride in that, I think so.
So how did animation become your life? Because it's been your life
for a long time. Yeah.
Yeah.
I was studying to be a graphic designer in Dublin in an art school, because I couldn't convince my parents or anybody. That getting into film was a respectable job, like a lot of us, right?
But that's what you really wanted to do from the time you were a kid?
Yeah. I always wanted to be in film, and I could always draw. I was drawing from a very early age, like 3 or 4, and always kind of looked at the world through my drawings. But I loved film as well. It was kind of a natural. Entry into the film world to go in through animation, because when I entered, you know, classical animation was still, hand-drawn animation was still a huge thing, and Roger Rabbit had just come out, and The Little Mermaid had just come out, and there was this huge vacuum that needed to be filled with young animation talent, because you know, Disney was sort of in decline up till The Little Mermaid, and then all of a sudden they were bringing all these old guys out, you know, and trying to train them train the younger ones in sort of classical animation technique. So I got swept up in that whole thing.
So were you part of the Irish universe, or did you actually come over to Hollywood?
I came to Hollywood when I was 19 or 20 to work with this renowned Disney animator called Dale Baer, and I trained with him, you know, and worked on a lot of pictures and commercials and things with him, a couple of Disney projects, and I was kind of like an apprentice, you know, animator, and then you know I went back. I hadn't finished art school yet, so I went back to finish school. And then hung around Europe for a couple of years as an animator, doing commercials and designing. I worked in Germany and France, and just You know, and then the opportunity to come back to California came up, you know, because Warner Brothers were starting this whole new studio, and then 3 months later, you know, DreamWorks started this whole new studio, so there was this massive demand for, you know, animation talent, and I ended up getting on a plane from Germany and going straight to California, bought a one-way ticket, and never looked back.
So was it Don Bluth thing? That was in Ireland, wasn't it?
Yes, Don Bluth and Murakami Wolf.
Was that so? Was that too early for you, or too not interesting?
You know, at the time, I wasn't really a huge fan of the Bluth films. You know, like they just the kinds of stories they didn't really. I was more interested in the story aspect. You know, beautifully animated and all that, but I never really had any interest in the movies and that they made, and I wanted to. I mean, I was kind of back then. I was kind of more interested in, you know, Roger Rabbit had come out, and I just loved the fact that you could combine live action and animation. I was interested in visual effects and telling stories with I mean, the first computer animated movies like Pixar had just. They had done Wall-E, that little short, you know, and that was just like, how did they do that? I was like fascinated by this three-dimensional world, and really wanted to get into that, you know, and then of course, in 1995, I think, or 96, Toy Story came out, right, and just blew the lid off everything, and just you know.
But you were involved with Space Jam, so that
yes,
kind of spoke to your. Wishes.
That yeah, was. Yeah, and I loved the idea of shooting a movie and then adding in, you know, characters that, you know, were sort of, it was like magic to me or something. I just loved it, the combination of animation and live action. And
you knew Osmosis Jones was always going to go wrong.
Yeah.
Ultimately.
Yeah. Yeah, so you know
that was an ill-fated production.
That was an interesting experience because the Farrellys were directing, you know, the small live action. I thought the animation segments worked pretty good in that film. It was nicely, you know, it was nicely designed and animated, and but it was just kind of you're right. It was kind of an ill-fated project.
So how did you end up being part of the Sony family? Because you've been there for a while now.
Yeah, I was working at Warner Brothers. I worked on The Iron Giant, and when that sort of came,
get that Osmosis Jones taste out of your mouth.
Yeah, exactly.
A little Brad
exactly.
Okay.
Yeah, and yeah, a little palate cleanser.
It's a great movie they couldn't sell. It's better than a bad movie they couldn't sell.
Right, right, okay. Right, exactly. So I ended up, working. Rob Minkoff asked me to work on the Stuart Little picture, Stuart Little 2, and I ended up, you know, working with a great little crew on that, Tor Freudenthal, who's gone on to direct himself, and it was a live action movie, a kid's story with this amazing digital mouse that Sony Pictures Imageworks were doing, you know.
So were you a specialist at that point? I mean, do you have, like, are people going, okay, you have a specific skill set that not everybody has, and that's why you were...
Yeah, I was jumping back and forth a little bit, you know, I guess I was one of the first sort of story artists to jump between, you know, live action and animated movies, you know, and the fact that now digital technology was allowing people to create these characters, you know. It meant I was sort of a natural fit for that. And I ended up working, you know, on that. And then I worked on Spider-Man with Sam. And that's how I was working on and off with Sony, just in the live action with Sony Columbia. With Stuart Little 2 and with the Spider-Man movie, and then Sony Pictures Animation started a new division, and you know, I kind of went back to that, you know, for a little while, and then ended up staying there for 10 years working on all their stuff, you know. And what was interesting about that place is there was a lot of different kinds of projects that would come through because they had their visual effects arm, which is Sony Pictures Image Works, which actually helped us make the Angry Birds movie. So I got to know everybody there, and you know, I worked on live action movies and animated movies and helped directors out that had projects, like Jon Favreau brought a project in that he wanted to do mocap, and you know, I helped develop the first Smurfs. I shot this test and, you know, put the little Smurf, Peo Smurf, into this little scene, you know, and very different from what the movie came out to be, but it was kind of a I got to do a lot of different kinds of little things, you know,
So is it always reinventing the wheel, or is it, I mean, if mocap is moved along by one company and the next, I mean, is it, are you trying to figure out what they did? Are you adding to it, or are you just building on what the framework that's already there, or how does all that?
You mean in terms of the process, like?
Well,
I mean, the advantage with mocap is it's just a capture technology to try and capture the actor's performance. Mm-hmm. But you know, the particular project it was, you know, it was called the Neanderthals, and it's interesting that Jon Favreau has now gone on and done The Jungle Book, which used that entire sort of mocap technology. I think he was always interested in it. He was interested in new technologies and how he could harness them to tell his stories. So, I mean, the process is the same. You have to build and model your characters and build your world, and then you almost shoot it like a virtual film, you know, and block it the same way as you would a live action movie, you know.
Which is interesting to you as a creative person, or
I'm interested.
Something was different, or
yeah, I'm interested to see what the technology fascinates me, you know, and I'm interested to see where it's going. Like the guys on Avatar, you know, good friend of mine Richie Bainham is the animation supervisor on that project and on the sequels, and they're pushing that technology again, you know, to do entire new things and create a new pipeline, and that's, you know, it's kind of utter games technology is feeding into film technology, and virtual reality is now sort of going to become the new thing, right? And that's also using, you know, elements of those technologies blended together, and it's kind of fascinating right now, sort of, to be, you know, to be able to create stories that use all those technologies.
So when you're in the midst of that, are you a technologist and an animator, or are they the same thing?
For me, it's always the primary thing you're doing is you're the storyteller, and these are just tools that you're using, you know. And it's about learning how to use the tool well, you know, and not letting it intrude on your storytelling. I think that's the key with all this stuff. Even as an animator, you know, like back when John Lasseter did Toy Story. There were certain things that the technology just couldn't do yet. You know, like it couldn't render certain kinds of lighting, or it couldn't. You know, the rigging of a character was very clumsy and hard for the animators to learn to do. And they, it's kind of amazing what they did do on that movie. But as you know, as the technology developed, that all fell away, and it becomes easier and easier, and it's just the tool then, and you're free to create what you want to do, you know. And it's
Start little one to start little two, I guess, is the one of the giant leaps.
Yeah.
In changing. As I recall, Start Little One was shot a couple different ways before they finally ended up making it all animation.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. They probably tried puppets and all kinds of, you know, stuff, and even
I still want to see that film.
Yeah, it's actually the first one. They're both really really good little films, I think. You know, like they're very appealing characters, and you believe Stewart. You know, mm-hmm. part of that is how well it's animated, and part of it is the story has a real good heart. You know, it's and part of it is Michael J. Fox. You know, just very appealing.
So when did they come to you and say, Angry Birds? You're the Angry Birds guy, obviously. It's so clear.
Well, you know, it's strange because Angry Birds at that point, it was totally a Rovio project, you know, mm-hmm. and I was just happened to be working at Sony at the time, and I was developing a project with Sam Raimi called The Familiars, based on a children's book. Really great, fun project. And Sam and Josh Donnan were producing it, and we were working on that for a couple of years. Myself and the Pixar director Doug Sweetland, you know, we were together on that and sort of developing that, and then I got a call from the producer of Despicable Me, John Cohn, who's the producer of the Angry Birds movie, and he said, you know, he said very candidly, he said, we're making an Angry Birds movie. Do you want to come in and talk about it? And I was like, it roused my curiosity straight away, you know. Mm-hmm. And I was like, the app, you know, which I was addicted to at that point as well. I was playing it. I love games. I play all kinds of both the terrestrial stuff and also app stuff, you know. Mm-hmm. I loved Despicable Me. I thought it was a very clever film and just great character, and tried to do something different. And so I went in and read the script by John Vitti, who's, I love John's work. You know, he wrote some of the best episodes of The Simpsons and Arrested Development, and just real smart dialogue, great comedy, you know, writer. And when I read the script, I was like, oh, okay, they're going to really try and go for something to turn the audience's expectation. I mean, the first thing was the birds, and they all have wings, and they all articulate, and they have feet, and you know, it's got real kind of smart snark in the writing, and this character Red, they're not shying away from the fact that he is an angry guy, and I was just kind of like sucked into it then, you know. And then he told me, of course, I met Clay Cadis, who's my directing partner, mm-hmm. and I love Clay's work. I mean, I thought he did an amazing job on Tangled, one of the best movies Disney Features have done in recent years, and so I knew that the quality team was coming together. David Maisel, who was producer on Iron Man, he was also involved, and so they weren't gonna shy away from making sort of a really attempt to make a really quality, you know, animated feature, CGI feature as good as, you know, trying to reach, you know, what Disney or Pixar or DreamWorks were doing.
So were you looking for a gig as a director? I mean, to be a director in name finally, or I mean, kind of like waiting for that moment?
I was directing this project at Sony Pictures Animation, the one that with Sam. So I was already sort of doing that and working on special projects and developing stuff for a couple of years. And yeah, I mean, to actually get something made, because the animation gestation process for project is so long, you know. There was a great will to make the Angry Birds movie. You know, Rovio really wanted to do it by themselves, and
did you look at the other their cartoons?
I looked at it. They gave us all that stuff. They gave us libraries of stuff, but they were very good about allowing us the freedom to sort of just create entirely new personalities. I mean, really up to that point, you know, they're just iconic. They're iconic little, game objects, you know, right. Like they don't have any personality,
or
really.
Voices. They
yeah.
don't talk in those.
Yeah.
Circles.
Yeah, and they don't really articulate. It's just, you know, they're the icons from the game, and, and it's a puzzle mm-hmm. game. So they gave us sort of a blue sky to create the personalities.
No,
yeah. Even though they can't fly.
For the three, but, no, for the blue sky joke. For the four people who are watching this, who will know what blue sky is.
Yeah. So you know, they were great. They were great about sort of, you know, Mikhail Head particularly, who was one of the founders of Rovio and one of the founders of the game. He was he just let us, you know, really get in and throw ideas out for the characters and bounce stuff off John Vitti and then when it came to casting, you know, we had a sort of a fairly good idea of the type of character that Red needed to be, and it was a matter of finding the right voice, you know, mm-hmm. and we almost got our first pick in every situation. And the other thing is, we wanted to signal to the audience that, you know, this is a comedy, it's a family comedy, and we're going to use the best of the best comedians that we can find, you know, and you know, they may not be big names yet, but they're going to be funny, you know, and and in many cases, you know, now they are sort of starting yeah. to come into their own.
So is it weird to have a conversation where you're, you know, oh, Red wouldn't do that? I mean, did Rovio, was that conversation? I'm sure it sounds like they were pretty open, but.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, it's funny. We never had those kind of conversations. We always had conversations about, we had a lot of conversations about how to make anger appealing. About how to make it relatable, mm-hmm. you know, like, because anger is such a great subject for comedy, you know, and as long as you're not the victim of it, right, or you're an observer, you know, it can
right.
be super funny. So, you know, we asked ourselves a lot of questions like, this guy. You know, why is he angry? What are the things that, when he goes through his day, really set him off? What are the things that set us off? You know, and it was always about trying to find the funny in the anger, you
yeah.
know? And of course, then you realize there's a little bit more to Red, and, you know, he's an abandoned kid, and, you know, his egg was in a lost and found, and spoiler alert. But, you know, he anger is driving him at the beginning of the story. Mm-hmm. It's controlling him, and then at the end of the story, he sort of is controlling it. He learns to sort of control it, you know. So, and it's a very natural emotion that just people kind of, you know, they stay away from. But it can be used in positive ways, like every other emotion, you know.
Well, I know what watching the movie, I kind of was thinking. For instance, there's the threat to the eggs, and I was like. I guess if it's threatened, it's funny. If it cooks, it's not funny. Like, if they, like, cook your eggs,
yes.
not cook your eggs,
yes.
even though they're being threatened,
yeah.
you have to, like, figure out how to use a slingshot and, you know, what that means
right.
in the context of the storytelling.
Yeah.
Because ultimately, some works for some people and doesn't work so well for other people.
Yeah.
It's kind
yeah.
of fascinating. And then, of course, like, adding the other characters into it and the things that people, I guess, are expecting from an Angry Birds series of characters.
Yeah.
It's a great challenge.
Yeah, yeah. And it's funny because a lot of that stuff we didn't restrict ourselves at the beginning. You know, the slingshot was always a part of the story.
Mm-hmm.
But then we decided, you know, later on to just turn that on its head and, you know, can I say what happens?
Sure.
Or, you know, but you know, the slingshot breaks and then all the other stuff, we kind of just folded it in very organically. Like for us, like any animated movie that I've ever worked on, it's always about creating the personalities of the characters and then finding relationships that are central to the, like, it's about relationships, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And in animation in general, I think in feature animation, because you have 90 minutes to tell your story generally, it's the character that's driving the story. It's not plot that's driving the story, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Other genres of film or just live action film in general, I don't really consider animation a genre, but it's, you know, plot can can be more important than character, you know, in many cases. So, but it's always primary in animated movies that the character is sort of driving it. And so we started off with Red, and then the DNA for all the other characters sort of came from him, literally. even the design DNA, we started with his model, and then the hundreds of other birds we modeled off sort of, you know, distortions of Red in different ways, you know, changing his genetic, you know, design makeup. Pardon?
How their legs are working.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Well, you know, I guess story-wise, it actually reminds me kind of an extended version of a Gilligan's Island episode. I mean, it basically is a Gilligan's Island episode.
Right.
You know, you have the island of happy people, even though they're stranded, but they're pretty happy, and then strangers come, and everybody, they're very nice to them, and then they
Yeah, it never occurs to them that there's anything else out there, you know, like they're sort of, it makes them comically naive, because all they know is sort of the beginning and ends of the shores of the island, you know, because they are a contented community. Yeah, they're happy birds, with the one exception of Red, you know. And of course, you find out later that there are other characters who have issues as well, like Bomb and Chuck, and it's not all a totally homogenous happiness, you know. It's sort of, so there's other, and of course Red meets these guys, doesn't like them at all at the beginning, but then you see how they start to connect in ways, and they kind of, they force him to sort of come out in the open and sort of confront things about himself. And
it's a little subversive in this regard. It's kind of like, you know, don't be too happy, use your anger. You may need your anger, store it up and use it when you need to.
Yeah, and I mean, we didn't consciously go in with messages or anything like that, you know, but you find after a while when you just play with the material and just even working with the cast and certain, you know, we would try ideas out, that themes and ideas start to emerge, and some of them are more prominent than others, or just, you know, kind of below the surface, or yeah.
So did it feel like other movies to you? Or did it feel like, I mean, did it have that feel of something like, I mean, were there boundaries, I guess, in terms of it being based on Angry Birds and all of that, that felt a little bit more like it was a little more insular? Or did it feel like you had the whole world to, you could make the movie you wanted to make, and that was wide open?
Yeah, I think it was wide open. Certainly the comedy allowed us to kind of stretch in different ways, you know, and that kind of just led to, you felt that like you were creating something brand new, and it was a new world, and the characters could do things that you might not be able to get away with in other animated movies, you know, because they are
new stuff in there.
Yeah. Well, you know.
The piggies get a little bit frisky.
Yeah.
As it were. And, you know, you don't usually have therapy in an animated kids movie.
Right. Yeah, there's a lot of anything to, you know, I mean, you know, comedy is all about, like, exploring that stuff. And anytime it made us laugh, that was kind of like our barometer for what went in and what didn't.
And is there anything that was like, you know, this will upset a 7-year-old, or we have to be careful of that? Or, I mean, is there a target for the audience when you are making a movie like this?
We're always aware of certain things, but like 7-year-olds will laugh at a lot of stuff, especially if it's physical comedy.
There will be fart jokes.
Yeah, I mean, there's not too much of the fart joke, although we did have...
Literally, though, I mean, I think it's... he says she farts, right? There's like the...
Shoot fireballs from her butt. She shoots like...
There you go.
Yeah.
Close enough.
Who knows? My teacher shoots fireballs from her butt.
There you go.
And that comes directly from the game. I mean, Matilda in the game shoots these explosive eggs.
Which you never think about when you're playing the game.
You never do. You never do. Or where they come from. Or how they work.
How do you do that?
Yeah. But they do. Somehow they do. But, you know, and... And we just turned that into a joke, basically, you know, just pointed right at it and went, that's what she's doing, you know, so, and the way Sudeikis delivers it is so dry, and when kids hear the word butt, they start to laugh, you know, so, I mean.
I remembered it as fart, apparently, and it was just butt, so there you go.
Yeah.
I got an old man's perspective on butts and farting. And were any of those characters harder to do? I mean, I think my son's favorite was the blue triplets.
The blue triplets, yeah.
That didn't show up until the very end of the movie.
Yes, on purpose.
On purpose.
Yeah, we there was a lot, I mean, even there was a lot of discussion about the blues are very popular and people expect to see them, but we kind of felt that, myself and Clay felt that, if Red is going to rescue one egg, why not make it something, a reveal that's a special, you know, like a special reveal, and then use it to reveal these three little hatchling, blue hatchlings, you know. So, and you're tracking that idea from real early on in the story. You see the peck, the blue birds at the beginning, and she's sitting on a blue egg, and she says, I felt a peck, and the dad runs in, and then Red, you sort of see that little family throughout the story, you know, right up to the point where they're looking for their eggs and it's not there, you know. If people were really paying attention, the big fans of the game, they'd kind of feel that
they're coming.
Yeah, that they're coming, you know. But
and poor Sam the Eagle, or whatever. Not, is it Sam the Eagle? No, it's not Sam.
It's Mighty Eagle.
Else. Mighty Eagle.
Yeah.
Sam the Eagle's from something else. I don't know what it is.
From the Muppets.
Or some sort of animation. From the Muppets.
From the Muppets.
Sam. You know, he's a big, tall, yeah.
So is mocking the Mighty Eagle, was that anybody at Rovio go, oh, ooh, that's uncomfortable. We charge 50 cents for that, or whatever it is.
I mean, the thing about it is, in the game, Eagle just comes in and you pay for him to wipe out a level, right? And he's just kind of the easy solution to your problem if you can't solve it.
My child at four did over and over again, no matter how many Mighty Eagles I earned. He would use them all, and he sat down for 5 minutes, they'd all be gone.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, you know, but the thing is, for the movie, we kind of wanted to make him, we wanted to, this idea that he was this legendary bird, and he was, you know, we wanted to sort of twist the idea, turn it on its head, and, you know, nobody'd seen Mighty Eagle, and he doesn't appear until later in the story, and Red has always had this sort of belief in him, you know, because he's sort of like a surrogate, you know, guardian to Red, you know, even though Red doesn't even really know if he exists, you know, there's a statue to him in the middle of the village. And then when you meet Mighty Eagle, like we wanted to, he wasn't going to be a hero. He was always going to be sort of this bird who was well past his prime and, you know, and love to pontificate and love to sort of be bombastic, but you know, I thought Peter Dinklage did a really amazing job with that.
Like, he was very funny.
Yeah,
but it was like almost violent towards Mighty Eagle. And here's like Mighty Eagle is very important.
Yeah,
here he was like mocked to death.
Yeah, yeah.
But I guess that's the fun of it.
Yes,
that's the, and that, it's also, I guess, changing it so people's expectations from the game are not all that you're making.
Yes, exactly. And it's funny to watch that character. I mean, I think he's full of surprises. You don't even really know if he's going to come through or in the end or not. But then he does. And then he gets all the credit for it and Red gets none. So,
it's a cruel world. Angry Birds.
It is.
So do you then...
Just like life, right?
Yes. So do you now anxiously await Angry Birds 2, or do you exec produce Angry Birds 2 and make the next thing?
You know, I'm not sure. It'll all depend on this weekend, right? I mean, for me personally, I'd love to, you know, I have a lot of ideas and I'd love to sort of, you know, try other things and working on stuff. But, you know, I'm sure if the movie is successful that they'll want to do a sequel if the characters are liked, you know.
It's like the Die Hard of animated movies. Angrier Birds. But I mean, as a director, I mean, as technically your first experience, even though the one movie didn't go, is that, did you love that experience of being in that seat or co-seat?
I loved it, yeah. You know, it's, with animation, you're sort of making the movie in slow motion. So there's many, many challenges. Just like, I mean, in a live action movie, it's more compressed, mm-hmm. you know, like, but you're always the chief problem solver, you know, it's amazing to be able to like see something that's really completely, you know, completely created from nothing, just come to life and kind of take off in its own way. And you know, I had an amazing crew. I mean, Clay, my partner, we had our pick in terms of, you know, we had an amazing crew at Sony Pictures Imageworks. Danny Dimian was a visual effects supervisor, and he, incredible, you know, he worked on a lot of live action movies, mm-hmm. but totally got what we were doing. He's an artist in his own way, like, he paints and draws, and so he was perfect because we were sort of stylizing a world that wasn't super realistic. You know, it was, you know, even the visual effects that we have in it, we stylized them to a certain extent, you mm-hmm. know, water, explosions, flame, all of that. Like, you know, they look realistic, but they behave sort of slightly differently, you know, mm-hmm. so. You know, we had an amazing crew, and that was just such fun to see all these people create every day. And then they would get excited by their creations, and the animators would come in and they'd show you a new scene, and they would have tried something funny. And it was really fun to like sort of bring the whole thing forward at the same time. And I thoroughly enjoyed it.
And now it's going to theaters.
Yeah.
Now you can sneak him back and watch people laugh.
Yeah. Yeah, that's the fun part. It's watching people's reactions to things. And I sit in the theater and I won't even look at the screen. I'm just watching the audience.
And do they laugh at things that you didn't expect them to laugh at, or not laugh at things that you did?
Yeah, but both, actually. I mean, it's surprising what does make people laugh and that you didn't see coming, or you thought it wasn't. It's okay, it's a B-level joke, but then you'll hear somebody roar. And it's usually a dad, you know, like the dad will get something that the kid, yeah. The kids, like, they just, it's funny what they latch on to. Like Terrence, you know, the big red bird that's played by Sean Penn, that, mm-hmm. he's kind of a scary dude, you know, when you see him first.
How you ended up with Sean Penn in your movie, even.
I mean, we have to thank David Maisel for that. You know, David, you know, is friends with Sean, and asked him to look at the movie and would he be interested in doing a voice. Sean had never done a voice for an animated movie. In fact,
doesn't do a voice here either.
He's
the Groot of the movie.
He is. He's the Groot or the Iron Giant of the, yeah. you know, and so he, he looked at the movie, you know, we didn't think he was ever going to, you know, do it, even as a stunt cast, you know. Mm-hmm. But he really liked the film and was laughing and even had ideas that he was throwing out there. And then he, you know, he totally got the stunt casting of it and jumped in. And then when we had him, you know, at the record session, he applied himself with full concentration and full, like, he wanted to know how to change the character of his voice, and he worked on all kinds of, like, he was trying different ranges, and it was very hard in his voice because he was using, I think, tools that he'd never used before, and he was using sound, and he was trying all kinds of stuff, and he was applying himself just with such focus. It was kind of like, wow. It was kind of surreal to pinch yourself a minute and go, here's Sean Penn, and he's fully into this character, and he's like trying to like put on the character. He's trying to wear it. He's trying to get inside it. And even though it's Terrence, and he only communicates with grunts and growls, and you know.
And now you've directed Sean Penn.
Yeah, yeah, that was fun in itself, you know. It's funny when you have these guys in front of you, like Peter Dinklage or Jason or Sean. You know, the intimidation factor goes away because all you're thinking about is the work, and everybody is just focused on the work, and it makes it such a for me, you know, it was just a very natural experience, and you're just trying to problem solve, you know, and then you find a kindred spirit who you're doing it, and you forget about, oh wow, this is a legend, this is an Oscar-winning legend in front of me, you know, you're working with your kindred spirit, and you're just creating, and it's really fun that way. Mm. It's a great process.
Fun in the movie.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for your time. I appreciate it.
Oh, thanks so much.
Thanks.
Pleasure. Thanks, Dave.
Yeah, we slated, right?
Yes.
All right.